Good evening, everyone. My name is Don Robotham, and I have been chairing this series, which is the second one that we've had so far. Let me first of all welcome you all to the Grad Center. As we have said before on the previous occasion, this is your university, and we're absolutely delighted to have you as our guests. This is the second in our series, and we have a third planned later on in the year. And I'll tell you a little bit about the third one before I proceed. The third one is an event which, in keeping with the times, we are trying to make a little bit more political. Just a teeny bit. A teeny weeny bit, maybe even more. But we hope to have someone from Black Lives Matter, some persons from Black Lives Matter, and we hope to have a political figure, an active political figure. So of course, keep an eye out for that, because we'd love to have people to come and participate in this series with us. The first event we had was the film with Stanley Nelson on the Black Panthers, which some of you may have seen. And it was an absolutely powerful and remarkable event for which we have to thank Stanley, but of course we have most of all to thank our chairperson, Johnnetta Cole, who is who, as you know, is the director of the Smithsonian National Museum of African Art, and we're absolutely delighted that Johnnetta is leading us in these discussions and here today. Beside Johnnetta is Aaron Venugopal, who is host of Micropolis, WNYC's ongoing examination of race, sexuality, and identity, and he contributes to the NPR's Morning Edition, All Things Considered, and PBS NewsHour. We're welcome, Aaron. Beside Aaron is Vivian, am I right? Mm-hmm. Vivian May, who's director of the Humanities Center, an associate professor, women and gender studies at Syracuse. We're very delighted to welcome her. And beside Vivian is Wade A. Davis, executive director of You Can Play Project, former NFL player, Obama's LGBT surrogate, speaker, writer, advocate, a major force against homophobia in sport. And then we have our own New Yorker, Cristina Beltrán from NYU, who works on intersectionality, especially pertaining to Latino politics, political theory, author, appropriately, of The Trouble with Unity, which I hope we'll hear a lot more about. Well, The Trouble with Unity, as you can see, is an issue which we have to confront in a vigorous way now. When we had the first event, the political climate was completely different from what it is today. Today we face a vigorous and hateful xenophobia, which we must take a firm and solid stand against. And therefore, in doing so, in confronting this virulent hatred, which is being whipped up at every opportunity by all sorts of people, it's obviously a critical matter to have the broadest unity that all people who find and experience oppression in any form whatsoever unite and take a firm and positive stand for the world that we all believe in. So we're absolutely delighted that we move from Stanley Nelson to this kind of discussion, because it really speaks to some of the critical political issues which are confronting all of us today. So, let's go.
Here we go. Sisters and brothers all, good evening. If our brother Don were back on this stage and you looked at the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of us, would you agree that this is the way our world is? And despite efforts to push against it, this is the world. You have come in response to a title for this evening's conversation that goes something like, Neither Black Nor White. Not bad for what we're going to talk about. But in many ways, I think what we're going to talk about is really captured in these words of my shero, Audre Lorde, who said, there is no such thing as a single issue struggle because we do not live single issue lives. If we use academic speak, which folk around the CUNY Graduate Center use a lot, there's a word that we would immediately pull out. And the word is intersectionality. Pretty impressive, right? But because it so easily does capture for some of us this conversation that we're going to have tonight, I have asked two sisters and two brothers to just make opening statements, say whatever they wish to say, but to include in everyday language, what is it? Now, Vivian, you've just wrote a great big old book about this. But you know, each of you, in the work that you're doing, you're continuously asking us to understand our multiple identities as individuals. You're continuously asking us to understand that when we use such a word, it is not simply an academic description. It is in reality a call for social justice. So with that, who wants to be first?
Well, she wrote the book. I feel like she's probably got a lot to say.
There you go.
Right? Isn't that the gracious thing?
There you go. Perfect. Professor.
All right, so I just got thrown under the bus, but there we go. Okay. Good evening. As Johnnetta said, I just finished a book on intersectionality called Pursuing Intersectionality, Unsettling Dominant Imaginaries. So it's been a fun challenge to prepare 3 minutes of remarks on the concept. I said to Johnnetta, this is the ultimate teacher's challenge. You know, give us the haiku version of things, right? Or coming from upstate, where right now it's maple syrup time, you know, I gotta give that corny country metaphor. I can tell you that 40 gallons of sap is 1 gallon of syrup, true. So Johnnetta has asked us tonight for some sweet boiled down syrup and not some watery old tasteless sap, so here we go. Okay, so what is intersectionality, the 3 minute version? Okay, as we've already heard in Audre's words, it's a transformative worldview aimed at social justice. It's an approach grounded in 200 years of Black feminist theorizing and political action, and it seeks to dismantle interlocking systems of oppression, not just describe them. So intersectionality is deeply connected to political struggle and is oriented toward justice at all times. It focuses on multiple identities, but it is not simply about demographic diversity. Instead, it's about structural transformation. Intersectionality alters how we think about liberation and political action because it involves, here's another fancy Graduate Center word, matrix thinking. Thinking at the intersections. And in doing that, you have to highlight power differences within groups, and you call attention to simultaneous privilege and oppression, that complexity within. So intersectionality is about forging coalitions that do not place multiple identities or forms of liberation in a hierarchy or in combative opposition. Intersectionality names and contests the full architecture of inequality, including the hidden foundations underground of the structures of oppression. So intersectionality breaks open silences in thinking and in our policies. It unearths shared logics between political movements and identities, and it does not ignore differences within and between groups. So in short, intersectionality is a critical lens and political tool which draws on the lived experience of multiple identities to challenge inequality and combat exploitation. But unfortunately, I would say, and we'll talk about this maybe more tonight, It's often interpreted simplistically, and its roots in black feminism are often disparaged as well. So in other words, its radical history and transformative ideas are often not well understood, or they're treated trivially. So I've started by talking about what intersectionality is, but I want to kind of wrap up here by talking equally as much about what it is not. I would say it is not intersectionality if it is seen as simply about demographic difference or managing diversity, rather than dismantling exploitive systems and pursuing justice for all. It is not intersectionality if it is unmoored from social justice, origins, and radical aims. It is not intersectionality if the concept is co-opted to reinforce violence and domination. So by propping up whiteness, upholding homophobia, ableism, xenophobia, or replicating settler colonialism. It is not intersectionality if its long history in black feminist and women of color theorizing is ignored, set aside, or dumbed down. It is not intersectionality if interlocking systems of oppression are treated separately or placed in a hierarchy as if some forms of dominance are okay while others need to be eradicated. So there you have it. My condensed version of what intersectionality is and is not. And I want to close by thanking Johnnetta for gathering us here, and I look forward to engaging discussion and dialogue.
That was simply terrific.
Arun, you're up next.
I guess I am. Well, I guess it's all karma, right? Since I threw Vivian under the bus, I can offer you the poor man's sort of interpretation, so to speak, or rather the non-academics. And I was genuinely scared. I mean, so when I was throwing her under the bus, I was genuinely like, oh my God, I don't want to have to do this, because a week ago I was like, are you sure you guys want me on this? Because 2 weeks ago I was like, oh yeah, diversity, not black, white, I can do that. and then they said intersectionality. I was like, oh, I think I might be, I think I have something else that day, actually. I think a lot of people are genuinely intimidated by it, but I do appreciate the chance to participate in something like this, as misguided as my attempts may be here. But for me, this is something that I think as a journalist we encounter in a city as dynamic and as diverse and complicated as this. It is the stories that we encounter and try to convey necessarily have overlapping, I guess, or are complex in these ways. And I think that my understanding, to the extent I've been observing this, is that it is this word is a demand for nuance to some extent in how we examine and articulate the frictions that we observe in society, the conflicts that we see. Something that happened this weekend for me was instructive. It was the tennis tournament in Indian Wells, California, which, how many of you are familiar with this tennis tournament, Indian Wells? A fair number, but it looks like a lot of you aren't. In 2001, Indian Wells, which is one of the premier non-Grand Slam tennis tournaments, was the site of what is considered, what's arguably the most, notorious incident in modern tennis history. It's where Serena Williams was jeered at by thousands of people in the finals. As was, I think, Venus and their father, Richard. And it was considered a very ugly incident. She didn't return to the tournament for 14 years. I should also mention that Richard has claimed, her father said that there were racial slurs that were hurled at him at Indian Wells. She was the hometown girl, and yet this was the ugliness that was on display there that year. So she didn't return for a reason. She returned last year. This year, she reached the finals for the first time since that year in 2001, and there were these remarks made by the tournament director, which I'll read out to you because they've gotten a lot of attention the last day or so. The tournament director, Raymond Moore, had this to say, broadly speaking, not about her specifically, but he said, if I was a lady player, if I was a lady player, I'd go down every night on my knees and thank God that Roger Federer and Rafa Nadal were born, because they have carried the sport. They really have. So that wasn't the only thing, though. And I think for me, the next thing that he said was equally instructive. But you know what? I think the WTA, that's the Women's Tennis Association, have a handful of very attractive prospects that can assume the mantle. They have a lot of very attractive players. And so this is where I think, for me, the word intersectionality has some, I guess, personal relevance, because this man, Raymond Moore, isn't simply illustrating an ugly sort of sexualization of female athletes. He's speaking these remarks against a particular historical backdrop. Serena Williams is the reigning champion. She's the most iconic player in the sport. And when you say these kinds of things, it's not just something incidental. This is a smart man, and he's a man of power. And so for me, this is not just simply sexism. This is sexism with a very highly, and I think under-examined so far, sort of racial bigotry. And it's a form of keeping people in their place. And I hope that it's not seen devoid of these particular aspects, that he wasn't just being ugly in his sexism, but that he was also being seen as being coded, speaking about somebody like Serena Williams, who has had to defend herself in so many ways against her appearance, her build, her hair, the loudness of her hair, against her rival, who Maria Sharapova, who was in the news for other reasons recently, but who has always been, well, at least for some years at least, been the number two player, her rival, but has consistently out-earned her in terms of endorsements, I think by a factor of 2-1. Now, Serena can only do so much about that, but I think we can all identify that when he's objectifying, he's doing it not just as your standard male chauvinist pig, but with an agenda that is ugly, and I think ugly at this particular moment in history in a way that has to be outed. So for me, that's what makes intersectionality, I guess, a necessary lens, a necessary form of discourse. And to wrap up, I also think it's a form of a demand, not just for nuance, but a demand for power, a seat at the table. But I'll leave it at that.
Mm, well done. Thank you.
Since I'm the sports guy and you kind of put the sports out there, so I guess I'll go next. So let me be just very transparent. I, as an athlete, spent a lot of time with my head in playbooks. And I was first given my my first Audre Lorde book by a gentleman who spoke here a couple weeks ago, Mr. Darnell Moore. And it was the first time, and I'll be very frank, that I had ever been exposed to words like intersectionality. And reading bell hooks and Audre Lorde and Gloria Steinem really changed the way that I looked at the world. So right now I do a lot of consulting with corporations, and I'm often meeting with individuals who work with ERG groups, so these employee research groups. And what I often find interesting is I'll ask the person a question. I'll say, well, you know, if you have a Latino, lesbian, differently abled woman, which group is she going to go to? And they'll go, well, what do you mean? I'm like, well, is she gonna cut her body in half maybe, or in a fourth, and actually attend these actual groups? So part of my work is to get corporations, leaders, people who are in power to start thinking very differently about how they align their organizations so that they're thinking about their individuals as whole people and not just an individual segment. So that's one way that I look at the lens of intersectionality. I think the second way is through a social justice lens. So I am very involved in the Black Lives Matter movement, and I was thinking recently hearing Mrs. Brittany Cooper talk, and she was forcing us to think about women of color who, on one hand, watch their men be brutalized and killed by the cops. On the other hand, they within the home are brutalized by these same men, right? And then they also can be brutalized by the cops. So they're holding the lives of themselves and their partners in their hands, and they're sitting in an intersection, right? So they don't have power outside of the home, they don't have power in the home. So for me, it's how do we actually start to step outside of our own mirrors and think about the ways that other individuals kind of are situated within the actual world, and not just think about how we as individuals are impacted. I, as a male, could spend all of my time thinking about how racism impacts me, and the fact that I'm a gay man, homophobia impacts me. But that's just one really simple the language is as an intersection. But how do we start our social justice work at the margins for those who sit in multiple types of intersections, and then start our work there and work forward, and then we make sure that we get everybody? And I think that that's really what Kimberly Crenshaw's work started at, was that if we can start our work at the ones who have the least, because the ones who have the most will never stop fighting for what they believe that they deserve, right? I think that people in power oftentimes think that it's my God-given right because I was born male, because I was born white, because I was born able-bodied, that I should have these opportunities and this access. And I think that intersectionality challenges us to think about the world through a nuanced lens, through lens of power, and through the lens of those who sit at the margins. Thank you.
I think this is already on. How well done. So thank Dr. Cole and CUNY Grad Center for having us all. I will try to close up quickly. And like my sister here, I also, as a professor, have notes, because these other people are capable of doing this without them. So one of the things that I think is always really interesting is I think we, you know, Dr. Cole asked us to think about, we live in a highly charged, racialized climate right now, and what that means. And I think we are in a moment in which multiple identities are sort of constantly, they're simultaneously commonly referenced, but not really deeply understood. So I was really taken by the language of intersectionality, but I was also taken by the language of multiplicity. And so in some of the research I've done, so for example, looking at the Chicano and Puerto Rican movements, and so I think some of the things have already been said, that trying to find a theory that activists and social justice, people committed to those kinds of issues, can find a way to talk about their concerns, you know, in these particular movements as Chicanas, as lesbians, as women, as feminists, right? And thinking about the ways that a language of community can turn into a very silencing discourse, right? And that the language of community sometimes can serve to erase difference, as opposed to open up the possibilities of coalition. And so, though my first book was called The Trouble with Unity, it's not a book that it's against unity, but it's an acknowledgement that unity is something forged rather than found. And I think what Crenshaw offered us was a language to talk about how coalitions aren't simply something where already existing identities come together, but it's where people get together and say, what might we create together if we become a collective community? What might we find in common? Right, and so that's really a language of multiplicity building on itself and trying to figure out what together we can forge as a united vision of a political world, right? So I think that idea of multiplicity is important, and I think it's important because I think we still talk about like the Black community or the Latino community as if it's one thing rather than a multiplicity of things. And I think that we're afraid that if we talk about that, we're gonna somehow disperse ourselves in problematic ways, but I think it's important to realize that diversity, that there's something that grants people dignity to recognize their multiplicity. That to talk about people in ways that lack an account of multiplicity doesn't really capture the human qualities of those people. I was gonna say a little bit about Kimberly Crenshaw's idea here, simply that intersectionality is an analytic sensibility, a way of thinking about identity and power, to fight for visibility and inclusion. Kimberly Crenshaw thought about this primarily in terms of the law, and thinking about how gender discrimination was unable to account for the racial and gender diversity of women in the workplace. So it was an attempt to make feminism and anti-racism activism and anti-discrimination law do what she thought it should. And I think that's been an incredibly valuable language for thinking about the intersections that exist that are really critically important for making sense of the world we actually live in. So I'll just give one quick example that I think, because I think intersectionality is still an incredibly valuable rubric for understanding the world. And one way that a colleague of mine, a Latina feminist theorist, Ana Sampaio, uses the idea of intersectionality is she looks at how large-scale immigration raids on primarily Latino undocumented immigrants these sort of military-style roundups, she looks at how the relationship between race and gender impacts those communities. So for example, she looked at the idea that in the 2005 reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act, right, which is a law designed to protect women, was also a law in which there was actually concern about the undocumented. So it was a law that simultaneously criminalized the very women it was seeking to protect. Right, because it was unable to account for the fact that women could be both women and undocumented. Right, so she sort of does this interesting reading of how the Violence Against Women Act, while an important and powerful piece of legislation, didn't always know how to account for women in those kinds of multiplicities. So I think that's just for me an example of how this term continues to be incredibly valuable. I guess the last point I wanted to just sort of let us think about is, I think, you know, I come from a department, social and cultural analysis at NYU, where we teach a course called intersections. So we're very much all about, you know, you can't think about race without gender, you can't think about gender without sexuality, you can't do this work without thinking collectively about how all these practices work. But I think that one thing we could do more of is thinking about how intersectionality actually works among communities who actually also have power. So one thing, as a social justice strategy, but also as thinking about, so for example, we now live in a moment where there is more gender and racial diversity in public life than there's ever been before, right? We have Condoleezza Rice and Barack Obama. We have a presidential election with Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz. Double your fun, right? So you have these people who are there who inhabit multiple identities, right? These people, an intersectional analysis can actually help us understand how race and class and partisanship and ideology work together to produce people who are able to deploy multiculturalism for conservative ends, that's able to deploy conservative rhetoric in a certain way that allows it to become legible and more acceptable because of the racial difference they also present to the public. So we live in a time, I think, of racial complexity that is about communities that are still deeply marginalized, low-income communities who are still disproportionately Black, Latino, Asian American, Native American. At the same time, we're living in a moment where elites of color can also deploy race and gender and sexuality in unexpected ways that can actually shore up power. So I think an intersectional analysis is sort of more needed than ever before, because it lets us think about those kinds of complexities as opposed to just thinking, oh, if somebody is raced and gendered in a way that is typically othered, they have less power. Sometimes it can actually work to give them a certain kind of privilege on the public stage. So we need to think about intersectionality in really complicated ways because we live in deeply complicated racial times. So thanks.
If I asked each of you to identify one of your identities that you find yourself relating to the most, is that an offense against the concept of intersectionality, of multiple identities? Must each of us, as an individual, give equal passion to, care deeply in terms of social justice about each of our identities? I put two very different things out there, caring about and commitment to social justice around. But I wish you would, you know, I'm not asking for an emotional strip act, I'm just saying, each of us, myself included, every single person here is a walking case of multiple identities. How do you deal with them? Do you, you know, each and every day just look at yourself and give equal weight to? And do you struggle for social justice around each of your own identities?
I don't feel particularly anxious about my deployment on a case-by-case basis of, you know, the identity I choose in a particular moment or a particular space. And I suppose because, you know, like other people, it's sort of the air I breathe. And I suppose in a sense, it's almost sort of like a form of power to say I can nimbly choose whatever term. If I choose in a particular environment to just refer to myself as brown, but in another term, another situation, say I'm being interviewed and referring to myself as Indian American, but another day saying as a South Asian man or whatever it is, I think that I'm trying to think of how to address your question, but for me, it is a form of, I feel like I can set the agenda, set the tone in certain environments, not all. There's certain places, like I said, you know, that where I, earlier, that there are certain forms of racial discourse where you feel like you can only sit there and learn, and you follow somebody else's lead, or you just listen carefully. But in other spaces, I feel that's part of the excitement of being alive at this moment, and having these kinds of conversations that didn't exist when I was growing up as a kid in Texas. I didn't refer to myself as like, oh, I'm the Hindu kid over here kind of a thing, you know. My daughter's growing up in Queens, and she has a much greater sort of facility with this kind of a language. It's the air she breathes. So I think that, you know, Queens also in the 70s was Archie Bunker's, you know, playground, his backyard, and now it's a very different place. So I'm not sure if that quite gets at what you were asking. You think?
Yeah, I do. Wade, what do you think?
So I'm going to be as honest as possible up here today. So because I am male identified, I don't wake up thinking about that. Just based on the fact that it's so privileged, right? So I don't have to worry about walking the streets of New York City and worrying about my safety, right? But that means that I have a responsibility as someone who's a social justice advocate to center my thinking, my work, my activism around the whites, around the rights of women, right? I'm also a black gay man, right? I see myself as black well before I see myself as gay, because I didn't realize that I was gay until I was a sophomore in high school, right? But I knew that I was black based on the way that I was treated, so my blackness is definitely probably the most salient identity that I have, right? I'm also an NFL player, right? That's another identity that it gave me a lot of privilege for a while, and then once people were like, oh, you're not playing anymore, you're probably this dumb jock, so that identity I didn't want, right? So I think that oftentimes, no, I'm being honest, I think that oftentimes we play back and forth with our identities based on the situation and how much privilege that they give us, if we're being really, really honest, right? I think the reason why I'm the most enlivened by doing work to create the social, economic, and political power for women is because I do understand that until women are free, men can't be free either. Like, I really believe that, I embody that. Like, that is really kind of what I wake up and I think about. Maybe it's because I have three sisters. I was raised by a single mom for a short period of time, but I really saw the pervasiveness and insidious nature of sexism. And I think that that, for me, is kind of the way I try to live my life, knowing that I have so much privilege in every other space, right? Like, I can honestly say that the access that I have now is based on the fact that I'm a man. It's based on the fact that I have access to a certain language, right? You know, that I can say I'm this former NFL player. So I think that I'm always trying to challenge myself to say, okay, what privilege do you have? How do you create access for others? How do you advocate for others? And how do you go beyond being an ally to be more of an accomplice, right? So that I can show up in a specific way that doesn't center my issues that are just around me.
I was just thinking, Dr. Cole's question reminded me, when I was in graduate school, I remember doing research on Latina women acting politically on some question, and one of my professors said, are they doing that because they're women or because they're Latino? And I was like, I don't know how to answer that question. I don't know what to do with that, those combinations of things. But so I think it's hard, for me, it's hard to rank But at the same time, I really agree with one of the things Wade just said. I think that's really important here too. Is it's about context, right? The spaces we're in, and the way that one's identity feels very different in different kinds of spaces. And the second part I think that's really important here is about solidarities and identifications. So I think that if for those of us, when I read queer theory and I began getting involved in, you know, I was in college during ACT UP and realizing this moment was happening and really starting to think about homophobia and really starting to learn and taking classes in African American studies and learning about white supremacy and thinking about those questions. The power of those moments of identification isn't just about your own identity as what you are, but about who you want to stand with in the world, yes. Right? And who you care about and who you feel committed to and what things are making your life meaningful. So I think a lot of the times it's about creating that the senses of identification that we have always exceed our own identities. And I think the other quick thing I would just say is I think that there's also this interesting question of thinking intersectionally about yourself should humble all of us, because we all inhabit multiple identities. Every person, nobody's just one thing. So multiplicity is something that's, which means that I inhabit spaces of marginality and privilege simultaneously. And thinking about that makes me realize that I am going to fail in my solidarities, and I am going to get it wrong, and I am going to try to identify and probably screw it up. And being aware of the limits of one's own identity and the fact that we all carry privilege alongside marginality should make us humble in the coalitional work we do with each other, I think.
I agree with much of what has already been said. I mean, I think that the question you posed in some ways is a trick question.
Well, of course. That's my privilege.
I know. But in a sense that you you pose the question of kind of breaking things out into separate parts or into a hierarchy. And I think that, of course, as people have been saying differently, that the multiple identities are not only shape-shifting internally, but also how we are read externally, what people read onto us. It's about the identifications we make, but also the disidentifications. You know, disidentifying with white supremacy, disidentifying with homophobia. That's always a constant negotiation, but it's a false question in a sense too, because if I come out and say, oh, my sexuality or my gender is the thing I come to first, it suggests already that those things aren't already marked and imbued by my citizenship status, my able-bodied status, my whiteness and race. I mean, there's just, those things don't stand alone. I mean, I think that's what Crenshaw was getting at in terms of the law, but she also gave us history lessons, and I wanted to talk about that too, because she is pretty interesting in that 1989 essay, Demarginalizing, where she coins the term intersectionality. She's giving name to a mindset or a framework that she shows to be at least 100 years old. So instead of just citing the case law, it's about the law, but she then cites Sojourner Truth. Like, she can't necessarily find what she needs in the law, so as a good lawyer, she just finds alternative case law. So she finds Sojourner Truth and speaks her name. Anna Julia Cooper, and references her. And so I'm going to use Cooper to answer your question. The student turns the table on the teacher.
Anna Julia Cooper. And why not Mary Church Terrell?
That's right. So I'm going to use Anna Julia Cooper to answer your question. Cooper was a 19th century black feminist writer, educator, and activist. And in her 1892 book, A Voice from the South by a Black Woman of the South, she describes being in a Jim Crow train station down south. And she gets off the train, and she faces the two waiting rooms. There's the colored or Negro's waiting room at the time, and the ladies' waiting room. And she stands, and she says, I wonder under which head I come. She's exposing the idea that the presumption is that all the ladies are white, or all the blacks are men. I mean,
and some of us
are brave. Exactly. So she's doing that in the 19th century, and Crenshaw calls back to that, because this is a long-standing observation and analysis about identity that earlier black feminists, which, as you know well, I know you know it was a trick question, have asked us to kind of understand as a problematic question from the start.
You know, one of the experiences that I think each of us is having now is to hear large, complex, diverse, multi-identified folk addressed in singularities. It's the Muslims. It's women. It's immigrants. Would each of you, in your own way, say how you think there can be effective responses against what's going on in this country now?
I speak as a member of media who thinks that the media has failed to diversify and to acquire the skill set to do this particular function, to do this job. It's something that some of us in the media, obsess over. It's an incredible frustration to see the obstacles that are placed, between the mainstream media, so to speak, news institutions, and people who want to enter it and to bring their skill sets to help understand and explore what's happening in this country, what's happening in society. I kind of came to the realization of this particular thing that you just mentioned about like the Muslims several years ago when I was reporting on the Ground Zero Mosque or the Ground Zero Mega Mosque or whatever you want to call it was called back then. And you realize that even somebody, this imam who was seen as like the devil incarnate by much of the country, who had at the same time been vetted fully by the State Department. He was traveling around the world on behalf of the State Department, which anybody with half a brain knows you don't just get those kinds of appointments without being, it's not an easy thing to be put in those positions. And yet this person is seen as like, who is this nefarious actor who's doing all these things? And that's when I saw the deployment of this sort of like, it was this kind of the mob mentality, but at the levels of the national news media, where it was the inability to see that one Muslim could be different from another Muslim. Even as I was in that space, it was kind of shocking. I hadn't realized before that how dumb the news media could be as a participant in something so close. So, I think that is, from my perch, that's the thing that has to happen, is they need to move that needle, and I say they because I don't necessarily associate myself with the people who are in power, who have those, who have the power to really invest in a more diverse, and not diverse in just the most superficial way. Diversity is complex. It's all the ways that we're kind of addressing up here. But you can't really understand the country unless you have people who have some proximity to those issues. A newsroom that is informed by more sort of vibrant discussions, that you don't have to speak in the abstract about people who are not in the room, So that's one solution.
Cristina, in your book, you basically make the point that it's really a challenge to a democratic way of thinking to talk about, in a sense, the Latino/Latina agenda. And we could even become more specific and say the Latino-Latina vote, or the black vote, or the gay vote. How do we move beyond that at a time when many individuals, although with multiple identities, are still feeling a kind of primary identification? Mm-hmm. Are you hearing me on that question?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think one of the really challenging issues is that demonization of any population is partly what creates a sense of a collective we, right? When a population is experiencing anti-Asian violence, people don't care if they're Japanese or Chinese American or South Asian or Pakistani. There's a kind of generalizing, you know, I mean, the fact that we're debating immigration in this country and that immigration has been so Mexicanized, when there's so many other populations that are undocumented that are not being heard. I mean, we've erased Asian voices from this conversation in really critical ways. I mean, at the grassroots level, there's all this organizing going on among those communities. But you wouldn't even think that immigration, I mean, we're not talking about it nationally for some of the reasons we've been talking about. So I think that demonization produces a sense of we, a sense of collective sense of self, that can end up being resistant and powerful. But I think the trick for us is, how do we not re-inscribe ourselves in simplistic ways? And I think that sometimes, especially in the language of the media, that we wanna do things very quickly, we feel like we have to tell the story very fast. And I think we have to demand complexity and talk about all the different ways that these communities can be. You know, when you have a choice of two parties, there is a black vote that goes to the Democratic Party. There is a Latino vote that goes about 65 to 70% to the Democratic Party. But there's so much political complexity within those communities that we should be discussing and we should be talking about. And so I think it becomes a really interesting question of how do we not, and not accept the bait of a kind of representational claim that we get a lot of authority speaking on behalf of communities that partly we gain authority speaking on behalf of them because they are not part of the conversation collectively enough. So we speak for them and we speak in generalizing terms, and so we have elites out there who I think are actually making people stupider about the communities they are designed to represent because they're not elected, right? None of us are. I'm not the, you know, I mean, I just write about this because I choose to, but we all play a representational role, and that can be played well or poorly. And I think one of the things we should be doing is talking about the fact that there is so much internal complexity, and we should be trying to complicate simple narratives, but that takes time and energy in ways that I think sometimes the media logics we live in don't want to do. They want a fast, simple story about these communities, and we have to resist that, I think, at every turn. Go ahead,
Ben. I think the other piece about using the Muslims, the blacks, is it segregates you, and when you segregate a group of people out, you render them vulnerable. Right? So I think that there's an intentional vulnerability that we're trying to create. You know, if you look at let's say poor communities of color, when they're vulnerable, things like Flint, Michigan happen, right? You can look in communities all over the country. I often tell my friends this, that you can go in any poor area and you will see a payday loan place, right? That's a form of predatory lending that you will only see when a community's been segregated out so they can be rendered vulnerable, so you actually can strip them of their rights, of their dignity, of everything. So that's what this, I believe, that it's about. I think, to answer your question, is how do we change that, is I think that Kimberly Crenshaw offers us that, and she shows that intersectionality means that we're all connected at some level. I was at a meeting with I won't say the organization's name, but the person was saying, like, I'm trying to do all of this diversity work, but those people just don't seem to think that they ever have enough. And I was just like, wow, like, maybe that language of those is the problem, right? So how do we move from those people or we versus them to an us? And I think that if we can start to see how we're truly all connected, right, at some level, I think that that's how we get the work done, to remove that distance so we're not as vulnerable, so we can tell these complicated conversations, and then there's a collective power that we all have. And I think that's part of how the work gets done.
I'm sorry, real quick, I just wanted to add one quick thing I think you raised, which is really important, is intersectionality should also be about specificity. I mean, one thing we're really talking about here is the importance of black feminism to intersectionality. And so I think things like Black Lives Matter, where we say, let's talk about white supremacy in terms of chattel slavery and people who were both capital and labor, unpaid, uncompensated labor. Let's talk about Jim Crow segregation. Like, but we should also be talking about conquest and colonialism and other forms of settler colonialism. But intersectionality doesn't mean a kind of mushy diversity where we don't talk about the specificity of particular communities and the particular oppressions they have suffered from, and that we stand with those. That is my problem. That is my agenda, right? Like, how do we, I think that sometimes the language of intersectionality became a kind of everything multiplicity in some people's brains, but really it's about really identifying the specific histories that that were talked about by Vivian.
Vivian, you've helped us to understand that this concept, while useful and powerful and associated with social justice, can also be misused. And most importantly, I think you're helping us to understand that it can be depoliticized. Would you say a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, I'm trying to think of some concrete examples because I think that helps make it more tangible. My training is more in literature and philosophy, but I had to go down a deep, dark policy hole for that book and read a whole bunch of European Union policies. And I mean, there's a lot going on globally with intersectionality being taken up by various states as an equity principle, as an equity practice, as a research methodology. People think you can kind of just pick it up and use it, but often, even with good intent, it's being used in ways that really violate its premises and actually reinforce some of the things we've been talking about, like this us-them thinking, which really is a foundational concept of supremacist thinking. I mean, it creates the, you know, so then you end up using intersectionality to uphold supremacy, and you think that's not right. So let me give a couple examples. One I can think of is in the Canadian context. You know, we think of our neighbors to the north as those, you know, more liberated, northern, benign people. And the Supreme Court in Canada gave a ruling trying to take up intersectionality in the courts in terms of judicial sentencing and decisions, so that all federal judges were supposed to draw on an intersectional framework when making sentencing decisions. This came about because the Canadians noticed that Indigenous women in Canada are, I hate this phrase, actually, disproportionately represented in the prisons, as if there's a proportional representation that's okay, but let's live with it for a minute, okay? Like, as opposed to prison abolition, but we're gonna go with the proportional representation in prison idea for a minute. But the way in which it was enacted in the law required the judges only to look outward at Indigenous communities intersectionally, not looking at how the Canadian state as a settler state and how, you know, and how the judges and the carceral system and the judicial system, which of course breaks every treaty in sight, has created the injustice that lies before us. So what happened in Canada is when the judges were using we're doing intersectionality air quotes here because it's not, right? The intersectional decisions, judicial sentencing, the incarceration rates for Native women went up. They were already really high, but it came about this way because the judges decided that Native women came from, they were using this kind of pathologizing lens, we'll call it the Moynihan lens, after the Moynihan report. So Indigenous women are coming from poor communities full of violence and poverty, coming from nowhere, I guess. And so we will save them from their own people by putting them in prison, which is nicer and better for them. So that's a really kind of tangible example of a really good intent. It came up through the courts, through kind of feminist action in Canada, through the court system, getting intersectionality on the docket, if you like, for federal sentencing, but it turned out upside down and backwards. It kind of went into the Alice in Wonderland version and became a tool of increased oppression and increased incarceration. That's just one little tidbit from my policy journeys, but that's an example.
That's an example. Well, I do want to say that I think Kimberly Crenshaw should feel mighty good about the work that she has done to give all of us this way of looking at ourselves in the world. But I also want to lift up again, as Vivian has done, the fact that this is a concept very rooted in Black feminism, which, and I do believe Beverly Gosch Efterall is here, we know from Words of Fire didn't just start yesterday. So we've got this concept. We've got this set of lenses. We've got a way of looking at ourselves and the world that certainly is rooted in Black feminism, that has been put forward so brilliantly by Kimberly Crenshaw. What are we going to do with it right now? And this is probably the last time we can each weigh in on this before we open up. If, dear sisters and brothers, you all of a sudden, don't ask me how you got it, but I just gave you this power to use this way of thinking and acting to do something substantial in the interest of social justice, what would you do?
I mean, you know, there's so much to do, but one of the things I think I would do is, you know, and I'm engaged with, is maybe in line with the Say Her Name project, which is intervening in endemic and systemic state violence and private domestic violence against women, but understanding violence intersectionally and women intersectionally. So, you know, what that might look like is really variable depending on location, context, and situations in which we are thinking about this and acting. So back to the Canadian example, for, you know, Indigenous women in Canada are 4% of the population, 24% of the victims of police brutality, and 29% of domestic violence. That's a different understanding of violence against women once you understand who are the women we're talking about and how do we think about the state as complicit in the private and public acts of violence. So then we go back and we think of Harriet Tubman and we think of Ida Wells. We can think of this long legacy of radical people acting to combat the state and refuse its terms of belonging. So I think a lot of what we need to do is to contest the state's terms of belonging and citizenship. And that's a lot of work to do, but that's my quick answer to that.
So I kind of have like this weird thought came into my head, and I'm reading this book by bell hooks about love. So I'm gonna go there. So just bear with me a little bit. So, as someone who spent many years not loving one of his identities of being gay, also hating having to deal with the identity of what the world offered to me because I was Black, I think that what a part of what Kimberly offers us to do is to love all of ourselves, right? And then I think you can project that forward and then start doing the work that is not centered on oneself, right? I think that oftentimes, I'll speak for myself, like I used to be so selfish about just worrying about me, you know, like what was impacting me. And I think that as I move to a space of self-love, I'm able to now worry about the other and worrying about what's impacting them on a day-to-day basis. So I think part of the challenge, and that maybe that the work has to start with loving all of ourselves, and then we can now go out in the world and do the work to remove that distance between us, because I think that that there is so much distance between Black, white, gay, straight, male, female, able-bodied, disabled-bodied, that if we can start to look at ourselves as intersectional and love all of ourselves, then we can start to do that for others.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
I want that to be yes. The world we live in. I think the only thing I would just add to think about is, for me anyways, is that intersectionality to me at its best moments has been an enactment of democracy, and so it's so undoing the state, but thinking about state power and the limits of state power, I think one of the things I've been writing a lot about is undocumented activism, and what it means for populations that themselves don't have citizenship claiming and enacting a richer, more vibrant set of citizenships than are often enacted by people who already have it as a status. So if you think about citizenship not as a status, but as a practice, what does citizenship mean? It's something we do together. If you think about democracy, something we do together, that we forge a common together through trying to imagine a world that we want to share and live in together. That democracy at its best is an opportunity for us to think about what do we want as a common, and not just in terms of market possibilities, but in terms of what would human thriving look like if we tried to imagine that together. And that means understanding ourselves as political actors in a regular kind of way. And I think that one of the most toxic elements of our politics today is that we consistently demean politics. Right? We always talk about no one wants to be a politician, and people will say, well, I've never voted, and we're like, that's, you know, there's something interesting about the fact that we talk about politics as if people who are political activists are treated as if they're less legitimate than people who, that there's something strange about being very politically engaged. I think we talk about people who are less engaged as kind of more authentic and real Americans than activists. We talk about activists as somehow this odd group of people who do these things who seem slightly other. Because they're activists, and so there's something really interesting about what would it mean to talk about that being political and sharing and trying to build a common with something that we do together regularly and ongoingly, and so I think to really have a really intersectional politics would be to have a democratic politics.
You know, one thing that I guess has happened the last few years is there's a great power online. Finding solidarity with people in virtual spaces. At the same time, I think we've realized that there's something very anxious that's happening in the real world. And so, to me, when I see young people, broadly speaking, but also my peers, you know, if I could, it would be to direct people to find community in their real physical lives. And I think that's a very, you know, big ask and a very big challenging thing. It's especially a challenge, I think, now. But that is, I think, the thing that I find is the magic sort of the solution to a lot of these things, is to find people in your real lives who you can be with. And it's the absence of that I think creates a lot of anxiety, but that's all I can really offer, really.
Well, I think we should broaden this conversation. Please, if you will go to the microphones either side of this auditorium, we await your questions, your comments. Don?
I just wanted to briefly thank everybody, but I wanted to raise a political question, if I may, which I felt is sort of hovering around the entire audience, and indeed maybe even more than hovering. We have, each one of us, we all have multiple identities, but we also have, to some degree, a principal social-political orientation. So some of us may be more interested in the gender issue. Fair enough. Some may be more interested in Latino politics. Some may be more interested in homophobia issues, and so on and so forth. This is perfectly natural. My question is, in the current political climate, where there's an onslaught across the board on immigrants, on Muslims, on Mexicans, on women, and in every single dimension, how do you explicitly counter this politically? What is the thoughts on this issue? How do you actually bring together people who have separate interests and forge something which has the breadth and the depth necessary to confront the sort of thing that is being faced today?
I think we should broaden this conversation. There may be a response among you that doesn't come from us.
Well, I just, one way to think about that, I don't have the specific political tactics in my pocket. I mean, my pants don't even have pockets tonight, but anyway. But I would say sort of the basic intersectional lesson is showing, you posed the question as we have separate political issues or principles or goals, revealing how they actually cannot be achieved unless we work across and among them. And in other words, unless we take up this both and coalitional solidarity forging work, we're really not going to achieve our separate, they're not really separable. They may be differently salient or come forward in different contexts, but how to really think coalitionally about those projects is sort of the basic starting place. And I think the other key intersectional lesson, if you like, is to continually work to break open the frame, show what's missing, expose the limits of the frameworks, like Cooper did in her imagined train station, or it was a real train station, but I mean, just sitting there and saying, there's this sign, and there's this sign, and then there's me. That immediately, she's doing work there to expose the falsehoods that the universal signs seem to represent. So breaking open the frames and exposing the places or the nodal points for solidarity so that those goals can be achieved collectively is, I think, those are the two strategies. I'll leave it up to the political scientists down there to tell you how to then make it happen.
The only thing that I would add is giving individuals access to information, right? I often think that we don't realize how important that the media or just what media that you get access to kind of has a specific agenda, right? And I think just for someone who works with young kids also is how do you get them that information that's accessible, right? That is put out there in a way where they can receive it and then understand it. We talked about that there are some academics up here, so part of my responsibility was like, how do I speak in such a way where it's receivable, not just for the audience, but for just myself at the same time. So I think part of my responsibility as a political activist is to share information that's accessible, that's in a way, and then be available for those individuals who want to start engaging me and asking really honest questions, because there are certain people who may actually look like me, have the same identity as me, and think they have the same politics as me, but have a different lens on what's happening in the world.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I mean, I want to have more of a conversation with the audience, but I think that maybe the last thing I would think about is we need to embrace agonism and political conflict in our coalitions. That I think that doing intersectional work is hard, and doing work across communities is hard. But at the same time, the anxieties people have that, well, how can I participate if, you know, I'm not queer, but I'm committed to queer politics, or I'm not Latino, but I'm committed to immigration politics, or, you know, how can I stand with women if I'm not a woman? There's all these anxieties, but I think one thing we have to remember, well, two things probably, is one is that none of these communities speak with a singular voice anyway. Each one of these communities is an argument in and of themselves. So if I enter into those communities, I'm entering into an argument and a debate in those communities. And so to accept the fact that we're going to argue, we're not always going to agree, that there are going to be winners and losers in some of these fights, and that those are maybe temporary losses and possible gains. But to understand that it's going to be an argument together, and not to be afraid of political conflict together as we forge, that the forging of something is going to also be an argument, and to be okay with the fact that that democratic conflict is a good thing. It's good for our politics. We're afraid of conflict, and then we let the people like the Trumps of the world kind of corner conflict. We need to perform some kind of, that's what, you know, black feminism has been arguing with white feminism. It was arguing with the civil rights movement. It's been an argument, and that's what women of color feminism has always done, has been an argument with communities you love, right? And so learning how to have arguments with each other, I think, is a big part of what this has to look like.
You know, I would like to add something. You know, whether it's conversations like this or much of the discourse that we're participating in the world, we haven't quite put a name down to the grievance that exists among the people who support Donald Trump, really. You know, this is a very newly expressed thing, newly expressed in the sense that I think it's caught a lot of people off guard. And if we're talking, you know, about tens of millions of, say, underemployed, white working class people, where do they fit into these conversations, you know? They're driving this country right now in terms of the political discourse, but nobody knows how to put, where to put them. So now they've found a home, or at least they've found sort of a concocted home. And so I think the, this has caught us so off guard because we haven't really been listening to those people. We're not talking about, you know, privileged people in the classic sense. They might have some privilege if we talk about it in the intersectional framework, but they're not feeling too privileged right now. You know, they're feeling kind of betrayed. And so they're in this limbo state. You know, they don't really have a formal political home. And I think now we're seeing the consequences of that. And I don't know what the solution is. And it's not going to be with an election, regardless of what happens with this election. That's not going to answer. It's going to be years. And now we're seeing the price that this country is going to pay for various. It's like various things are coming home to roost, not just decades of economic and political policy, but centuries of racial policy in a way that is really kind of coming back to bite us.
It was such a fundamental question, Don. Maybe there will be comments coming from the audience, but please feel free to ask your question as well.
Okay, well first, thank you for this very nuanced discussion. It's helpful also to have the language of intersectionality, new to me, clearly. two things I didn't hear mentioned, one maybe alluded to, was the role of art in all of this. But another one that I'd really like you to address is that of religion. I'm a gay man married to a black man, and we used to go to a primarily African-American church until we started hearing homophobic things coming from the pulpit from a new preacher. And now we're attending a very dynamic and diverse church, Riverside Church, which even has a gay ministry. So the question is that I'd like to ask you, it's more like just your thoughts on how does religion figure in all of this, whether we're speaking Christianity or Islam or Buddhism. In New York, we have it all. We have all the religions. So any thoughts on that, I think, would be what I'm looking for.
Analyst?
I have the same question, actually. So I'm just kind of waiting to hear one of the experts, because I do wonder, in all the various, say, primers that you see online on YouTube, but what is intersectionality? You look at that, and you see all these sort of subcategories, and religion is... I don't see a whole lot of that, so I do wonder if that is sort of a lapse or a shortfall, a shortcoming rather, of all of this.
Please, Vivian.
I mean, in terms of thinking through the history of black feminist thought on the topic of intersectionality, when I think of someone like Cooper, and she's not alone in the 19th century, kind of tapping into a liberation theology within Christian frameworks, obviously. She purposely references, for example, Matthew 25, talks about the least of these. Back to this question of thinking from the margins, if you like. So there is this kind of implicit connection in terms of a liberation theology framework, but I'm not sure that religion has been taken up explicitly enough. And it really needs to be in terms of thinking about global politics and domestic politics. The creative is another question you asked about, and I think there's a long legacy. If you think about fiction, poetry, music, these are legacies and places where resistant voices, alternative mindsets, different worldviews have been presented, shared, traveling the sound waves, the airwaves, the visual culture. There's a long history there of, in some ways you might think of intersectional activism happening through the arts, because the arts have helped transform people's consciousness over time, whether it's, again, through song, poetry. It's also a way of keeping resistant community alive, The arts have done that. And so there is a whole, there is some work on the arts and creativity with intersectionality work, but not a lot, and there could be more.
But I must add that at the same time that you've so wonderfully owned the creativity that's broadly cast and its role in helping us to move towards social justice, I have to also say that the arts have also been, unfortunately, places that have been most unwelcoming to folk with their multiple identities. And so I don't see the arts as having a very special history and her story of social activism. I see the arts as having both a tradition of social activism in struggle with extraordinary privilege and power.
That's a great point, because I think that the aesthetic itself and the arts are such a complicated space, and there's so many different sites of it. You know, are we talking about the film industry? Are we talking about mainstream music? Are we talking about, you know, television? And I think it's great that I'm really glad you brought up the arts, because I do think that, but I guess I do think that at times in our politics that the arts have been one of the places where there's been more capacity to do nuance than scholars do. I think of people like Key and Peele. I think Key and Peele are enacting intersectionality in ways that are kind of doing. They're literally performing it at times. And I can think of different examples, and they can be like, people may not like all of it. It can be funny and hilarious and offensive and all those things. And so I feel like the arts sometimes are a space where it's actually done in this really powerful way. And I think I do think that work. But I think you're right also about the spirituality is a space. Again, academics are a place where, you know, in places like the CUNY Grad Center, where we talk about these things in a certain way, but in spiritual life is where so many people, it's the place where we ask the biggest, hardest questions about the meaning of our lives, which is what we also do in the liberal arts context or in the humanities, but it's a really critical place where we ask, like, why am I here? What should I do? You know, they are the deepest philosophical questions, and we don't talk enough about religion as a site of, that's one of the most public places where people ask those kinds of questions. So it seems like a really critical place for us to be thinking more and more about.
Wait, I'm gonna ask you and Vivian to hold on just a minute. Let's see if we can get another question in.
Hi, I just wanted to thank you guys for this wonderful talk. One of the questions that I had is, as we think about sort of like intersectionality and like marginalized populations, one of the things that I find, especially on major news sites like New York Times, New York Magazine, there's a tendency of focusing in on these very small populations. So let's say Black Orthodox Jews or Latina Muslims, and we have a tendency of looking at them with this sort of colonizer's gaze that, oh, look at these weird individuals. They're not part of the norm. So how do we prevent ourselves and prevent sort of the larger media from sort of talking about these groups in very trivializing ways that doesn't necessarily break apart white supremacy? It sort of adds to this process of looking at the other as an oddity, as not normal, as not part of the system in some ways.
I think that we just have to figure out ways to walk in solidarity with those groups, and then also educate ourselves about those actual groups so that we can learn how to do solidarity work that doesn't replicate work that can be marginalizing, right? I think that, you know, Audre Lorde says you can't use the master's tools to dismantle the master's house. I think that oftentimes when we're trying to walk in solidarity with someone, we still do that because we haven't educated ourselves before we enter into that space, right? So I think that that's how the work has to be done. There's got to be an educational piece. There's got to be asking the right questions that don't make an individual feel like that they're now educating you, but you're saying, hey, like, I'm doing my work also, and I want to know, how do I walk in solidarity with you?
Well, I think the politics of perception are, you know, intimately tied to a lot of what intersectional work is about. Actually, an example I was going to give to the last person's question can help maybe answer yours. I was thinking of Black feminist artist Renee Cox, and she did a series of photographic self-portraits of herself. One famously was taken on by Giuliani when he was mayor. She did a portrayal of herself as Jesus at the Last Supper, and she's nude. She is Jesus at the table. Of course, by the way, Judas is white. And she did other religious imagery too, like she did a Pietà, the Virgin Mary holding a black Jesus, adult male in her lap, and a series of other things. She was claiming the sacred within black female embodiment. But that's not, you can't, but it was read as profane. I mean, the exhibits needed to be shut down. So you can craft radical intersectional art. You can put it out in the world, and it can be twisted and turned upside down and turned into an example of profanity or weird anthropological difference. So I think Wade's right. It's also about intervening, like how do we find ourselves sucked into dominant ways of thinking or dominant ways of perceiving or looking at other people or looking at an image and teaching ourselves to step away from that, to undo that way of seeing. So you could meet the sacred in Renee Cox, not the profane.
Thank you.
Can we move to this side, please?
Okay. Well, hello, everybody first, and thanks for coming, really. And I'll try to, I have a comment, but I'm going to try to wrap it in a question. And it's this. Every group that's actually working for social justice, I believe, has its place. It's actually working for social justice because there's so many different kinds of groups with so many focuses. But at the end of the day, and this has been brought up during the discussion tonight, is we have to have some place in our minds, what we could call a theory of oppression. Because all of the inequalities and injustices that we're talking about come from someplace. They all have a history, and we can historicize them. And ultimately, we have to think about the state. And we have to think about the rise of the state, the rise of interest, and the historical location of the beginning of all these injustices we're talking about. The subordination of women came along with the rise of the state and private property and so on and so forth. Patriarchy also. So ultimately, we have to think about that larger issue and what are the vested interests located in the state and its patriarchy and social stratification and wealth and so on and so forth. How do we apply that to our strategizing now? So that's what I wanted to plant on the floor, that ultimate issue and how we work, do our work within the framework of a theory of oppression.
I didn't fully, I think I've fully got your question. For me, it comes back to maintenance of power, right? I was at another meeting and I do work on diversity and inclusion, and I was telling this white man, as I said, when you hear diversity and inclusion, what do you hear back? And he gave me this large answer, but what he really heard was less of me. But that's actually what diversity and inclusion means. That's really truthful, right? It means that in this office space, there's going to be less white heterosexual men, right? And for him to actually hear that and receive that means he's got to give up something. And that something is power. So I think what your question is that where is it located at? Where's the root of it? It's the maintenance of power. And if I was to say, I want you to not work here anymore, I want less of you, he's also thinking that means less of my brother, less of my son, less of my grandson, right? And that creates a scarcity. So problem is that we all live in this scarcity model that we're afraid that at some point we're going to be extinct, right? So we have to figure out how to change this model that we're always thinking about. I have to maintain what I have, and that means if you gotta go, I'm okay with that because I gotta stay, and people who look like me have to stay.
I'm saying it really fast. I think that one of the things, I agree with that, is two things. One is that I do think that I don't really buy a theory of oppression, personally. I think it's theories of oppression. That doesn't mean I don't think that like capitalism isn't key to this story or certain things aren't central to the story. But I think that I worry about having a theory of oppression because I want us to be able to really explore the specificity of particular communities and the processes in which that group became marginalized or whatever happened. I want to understand that story in its specificity. And so I tend to always aim for pluralization. Is histories and
multiple and again?
Yeah, I want to go back to multiplicities, but so that's one story. But I think Wade's point is so important about mourning losses, and that means all of us having to mourn our losses in ways that aren't toxic. So, for example, if I'm in a department and there are more trans members of my department, that's going to feel less familiar for a department that doesn't have a lot of trans members, right? It's going to feel less familiar. It's going to feel less comfortable. How can we learn to be discomforted or made uncomfortable or made unfamiliar with the landscapes that we're used to and find that to be a space of possibility and maybe even mourn what we used to find familiar, but mourn that in a healthy way that can then say, this is the world I live in now and this is really exciting and possible and full of new pleasures and desires, right? But how do we like live with those losses and talk about them because we are letting go of what maybe was familiar or comfortable. And I think right now what we're seeing in our politics is a really toxic response to people who don't know how to mourn a real loss, right? It might be the loss of something we want to lose, like white supremacy, but it's a loss. And they're mourning it, and they're mourning it in an incredibly toxic way. But I think that there's something, we don't really have a language for mourning a new world that doesn't feel as familiar.
Mm. We have time for only two more questions, so please.
Okay, this question is mostly directed towards Vivian, but I'd like to hear everyone's thoughts. So I'm interested in the Canadian case that you presented with the judicial system using intersectionality. So I think it's very interesting because a lot of us academics, I think we'd like to see our materials and our studies turn into the materials for social resistance and intervention, but it's very troubling because it seems that even when we go in with the best intentions, it could turn into bad policy and bad practice. And so I wanted to know if you have any suggestions as to how we could stop or prevent these sorts of mistranslations. How do we stop good theory from turning into bad policy?
Wow.
The magic wand. No. Well, I mean, in that particular case, I would say that what happened was it was actually not a good application of intersectionality despite good intent. Because it was only a one-way, there was no look at power of the judiciary, of the settler state, of whiteness. There wasn't any examination from the judges, if you like, in terms of their social location, the power that they held in the sentencing decision, intervening in that colonial settler logic that looked at indigenous communities as pathological specimens of failure and not as ongoing sites of resistance and survival, right? I mean, so I think part of it is trying to align the practice with the ideas. And what happens so often with intersectionality, I would say, and I'm awfully suspicious of it, is the disparagement of intersectionality, which is connected to black and women of color theorizing, connected to the disparagement of black women and women of color as persons, like the body of thought and the bodies themselves, how they're treated. So what I often see is that people haven't really done their homework. They sort of cite some Crenshaw and maybe a little Hooks and Lord, I'm not sure they've read it. They haven't really done their work in ways that would be totally unacceptable in other contexts. If you were going to become a specialist in topic X and then turn it into a policy and bring it all the way up to the federal courts, you would have done a little more work. But again, how do you make people then do their work? Now that's the next question. But so one thing is just to keep, have the depth of training and to attend to the concept and to really line up and say, does this really match what intersectionality is about? That may not answer you adequately, and maybe others at the table have some ideas.
They just need more black queer women doing this work. I think that's what it is, you know. I'll just give a funny anecdote. I think it was Hillary that was asked a question, and my first, and she answered it. They asked her about privilege, and her answer was really bad, and I was like, there's no black queer women on her staff. That's the problem, right? Because otherwise she would answer the question a lot better. So yes, we just need more black queer feminist women in the court system.
With a radical consciousness.
Yes, 100%, 100%. Yes.
Thank you for this discussion, Bob Larrick. I just came from a UN mental health function at the UN on the status of women, and I had spoken to President Chase Robinson and other educators about the need for New York State being and city being a leader in these type of discussions. And if you look, as you brought out, if you look at Trump, you look at the world, there's just too much violence, there's too much dysfunctionality. I've been saying to the UN, and we did a whole World Spirituality Summit, actually, a while ago, which they couldn't handle. But the need for meaningful UN renewal was brought up. But what do you think of New York City, Mayor de Blasio is concerned about the violence, the racial issues. I work with various groups. The idea of all children of a universal soul, father, mother, creator, God, of innate worth. In other words, the issue of self-esteem, the idea of working together as spiritual, emotional individuals. Everybody's different, everybody's unique. And there's greatness when we touch into our better natures. The different groups, there's a World Association for Spirituality I was thinking about. There's a group I work with that says we have identity crisis. We think we're really physical beings, primarily, in a spiritual mode, but we're really spiritual, emotional beings in a body. The idea of how we see the issue of, I just came from the World Conference of Religion and Peace also. Peace as opposed to war, the issue of advancing the human condition, isn't that compatible with education? And don't we need a different type of a religious, political, and spiritual state and energy to work more constructively versus destructively for a better world? And isn't that a role of education also? And something that Mayor de Blasio should be involved with.
I'm going to go with Wade and say that what we need to do is dare to love and love radically in a time of hate.
And I'm going to suggest that we can't really bring closure, because if you own your responsibility to struggle against injustice, there's no closure. But Vivian just did something that was very, very powerful. In a single sentence, you said really what intersectionality is. Would anyone else like to try?
You don't mess up a good ending.
Yeah, that was like a mic drop. That was good, that was perfect.
I think she won.
Well, then let me try. I'm going to try by using words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. with an addendum. He said quite clearly, an injustice anywhere is an injustice everywhere. And perhaps what we have struggled to say tonight is an injustice anywhere is an injustice everywhere. It hurts me deeply, and I've got to struggle with all my sisters and brothers against it. Thank you all for being here.